हेलो एवरीवन, कैन यू हियर मी?
यस मैम।
सो टुडे वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट फीचर सिलेक्शन, फीचर एक्सट्रैक्शन पार्ट ऑफ एनी डेटा एनालिसिस। नाउ यू हैव सीन दैट देर आर मल्टीपल टेक्निक्स एंड the number of techniques that are being developed is again innumerable. So people are developing newer and newer techniques for perfecting the classification or regression issues. But in any data mining problem, generally 80% of the time is first spent on understanding the data, pre-processing the data, cleaning the data, selection of variables, imputing the missing data, and then deciding the exact strategy. The actual implementation of the algorithm takes hardly 20% of the time. Arranging the data in the required format, because you know, nowadays we have what is called as unstructured data coming towards us from all sources. For example, when you do a transaction, say when you do some online transaction, there are various things that get recorded. So the timing of your transaction, amount of your transaction, then the your ID as well as the recipient's ID, then there is a transaction ID, all such things get recorded. Similarly, when you shop online, or even if you shop in a say store or a mall where you have computerized registry, computerized inventory, then again, the timing of your transaction gets recorded. What type of products did you buy? How many quantities of each product did you buy? In fact, some if you are purchasing
हेलो
medicine,
मैम।
yes. Hello, can you hear me?
यस मैम।
Someone said hello, ma'am, and then stopped. Is there any doubt or was there any problem in hearing? Okay, but others can hear me fine, right?
यस मैम।
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So, if you are shopping for, say, medicines, even the batch of the medicine or date of expiry would get recorded. So, the data that you have actually comes in variety of format. It may be date, time, it may be pictures, it may be numbers, it may be brands, so it may be text data, etc. So there is a variety of data and it is unstructured data. In fact, sometimes even audio recordings might be there, sometimes video recordings might be there. Okay, and this is not just in the e-commerce business or online setup. Even in the traditional data collection mechanism, sometimes you may want to capture audio or video or image type of data. For example, we are working on a biodiversity project. So there, whenever a new tree is planted, or even whenever we are doing census of the existing trees, we generally ask the person who is recording the data to click pictures of the tree and of the leaves, and we try to store it in the same database. So that after 1 year, when we want to measure the growth of the tree, we have GPS location of the tree, no doubt. But you know, GPS location is ac its accuracy is limited. So whenever you are in a area with say dense forest cover, you may get confused about which tree exactly this GPS is telling you about. So you need pictures of the trees, pictures of the leaves to make sure that the species has been identified properly, and to make sure that next time when you take growth measurements, you take on the same tree and not an adjacent tree. Okay. So now, because of the advent of technology, the type of data that is coming to us is changing rapidly. And we have unstructured data because we don't have a data in a single Excel file where you know you have some numbers and they are arranged in a very neat tabular way with equal number of rows and equal number of columns for all the observations, etc. That is not the case. So to handle such unstructured data, you have to do a lot of pre-processing and data cleaning. And hence, as I said, almost 80% of the time in any data mining exercise is spent on understanding the problem, then cleaning the data and pre-processing the data so that it is amenable to further treatment as per your requirement. and then if there are any missing values, then imputing those missing values and then getting the data ready in the required format. Now, what do I mean by the required format? Because the data set might be huge, but you may want only certain points from it. So you may be able to reduce the size of the data, which would help you not only reduce the computation time, but also you can do the same things on a machine with a lesser power. Okay. For example, we had a few years back, a group did project on impact of urbanization on bird diversity. So we had taken data. So we had downloaded the data from a website called eBird. So what do people record on that website? So whenever an amateur bird watcher notices or watches some bird in the either in his or her own surroundings, or when he or she has specially gone for a birding event, then what do the record is, the website gives them what is called as a checklist. So in that checklist, what are the things that are recorded? So first of all, of course, date and time of observation. Okay, date and time of observation. Then name of the species of the bird. If they can identify male, female, then that male, female, if they can identify, it is not compulsory. And then count of the bird. Was it a single bird? Was it two birds? Or of course, you can't give exact count if there is a group of birds, but then approximate count of the bird. These things are recorded, and of course, the GPS location of the observer. Okay, so these things are recorded, and the data that they along with the GPS location, they also ask for the name of the area. They denote it by county. And of course, there is a district, state, and country, because they have data from entire world. Okay, so county is kind of locality. For example, say Ganesh Khind area, Shivajinagar area. Then they have district, state, and country. Okay. Now, in fact, village might also be there, I'm not sure. So the data that we received was, in every row, we had an entry only for a single species. Okay, only for a single species of the bird. So we had date time. So we had date, time as first two columns. Then name of the species as next column. Then count as next column. And then this county, district, state, we focused only on India, so we did not bother about country. And we had initially what is called as SEI, sampling event identifier, that was basically the checklist number. So every checklist means every report was given a unique identifier, so that if you have 10 birds, 10 different types of species that you are reporting in a single checklist, you will get 10 rows with same identifier. So you will know, in fact, name of the person was also there. Name of the person who is reporting this was also there. So if this person has reported 10 types of birds, 10 species of birds, then that person's checklist would get spread over 10 different rows, each row for one species. Okay. This was the data. And the total size of the data set that we received was around 84 lakh rows. Now, I don't know how many of you have, some of you might have handled big data, I'm not sure. But 84 lakh rows is actually too much for Excel. In fact, when we downloaded this data, students were unable to open the file in their laptops. Even in 8GB laptops, Excel could not handle 84 lakh rows. So what to do? If you can't open data set, how you are going to analyze it? Now, what we realized is, okay, so fortunately, in the department workstation, we could at least open the data. And anyway, generally, whenever such big data set comes, you have an additional information or readme type of file where they list all the variables and describe all the variables.
Excuse me, ma'am. Just to make sure, are you sharing the screen because we are not seeing
Oh,
it?
sorry, I forgot to share. You should have told me. Sorry. I thought I had shared, I forgot. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, ma'am. Actually, we thought that you are just telling it orally because we were able to understand everything. So,
okay, sorry. Okay. So, yeah. So, where was I? Yeah, so you have, yeah, whenever you have such big data set, you generally have an accompanying file called as README or information about data, where they list all the variables, give ranges or typical values for all the variables, whether the data for each variable, they specify the format of the variable, etc. So that even from that file, you can understand and try to write a code. And fortunately, as I said, we could open the file on the workstation. But the problem was workstation access was limited and students could not finish. They had a deadline. This was for a competition. So they had a deadline. So they wanted to do some analysis on their laptops so that they could finish by deadline. Then we first started thinking what can be done. Of course, nowadays you have servers for Amazon, etc. But and I don't know how many of you use those. But in those days, at least we were completely new to this and we did not know anything. So we had to somehow make do with whatever the laptops could do. Then we started thinking about the problem. The problem was impact of urbanization on biodiversity. And we were focusing on bird diversity because we had data for birds. So we realized that as of now, at least in the beginning, what we need is maybe at every location for every date, how many birds are found, how many types of birds are found, not exactly how many birds are found, because getting count is difficult, not just because you cannot count a big group, but also because two people might be reporting same bird. We don't know that, right? For example, we are like there are multiple observers in the university. So maybe in the morning I report certain bird and in the afternoon one of you sees the same bird and reports it. So actually adding your count to my count doesn't make sense because we have recorded the same bird. Okay. So we realized the first thing that the count variable here, even though it is available, it is not really directly in the usable format. Did you get this point? So even if you have certain variables available in the data, that does not necessarily mean that you can directly use that variable. You have to first check validity of that variable, whether that, I mean, is it really possible for that variable to give you realistic and reasonable values for that quantity? Okay, so here count variable, even though it is present, it cannot be used directly because multiple people could be recording the occurrence or the sightings of the same birds. So count does not really make much sense here as it is. Of course, you can develop some complicated algorithms to estimate the count, etc., etc., but that's a different story. At the face value, count variable does not really help us. At the most, what can be done is there, at least in some cases, if you have directly a multiple count here in every row, in some rows, then you can say, okay, so there are more than one birds found. Only that much you can do. So this is first thing, that you have to identify which variables may not really be useful to be, you know, directly, they may not directly be in a usable form. Okay. Again, remember, I am not saying variables which are of no use to you. That's a different category and that's kind of an obvious category. Okay. You comparatively, you can easily decide which variables are of no use to you for the given question. That is sometimes very easy to decide. But deciding that the variable which you have may not really be giving you reasonable values is a difficult exercise. So in any data mining exercise, you should first check that whether all the variables give reasonable values. Are you getting the problem here? Why count was non-usable?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so we realize that, okay, so count is gone. So now what we can do is, okay, so for every person, we have the different rows. So if a person reports 10 different species of birds, then you have 10 rows for that person. Then sometimes there are even more than 10 species. For example, when people go for specially a birding expedition, they see various types of birds. So we decided that can this way, by this way, can we reduce some number of rows? This was one thing that came to our mind. The next point was, do we really need exact day time? It may be enough for us to have, say, date or sometimes even month. Like, how many different species are recorded in, say, month of December in Pune? This may be enough for us. We may not even be interested in focusing on, say, sub areas of Pune, like, say, Ganesh Khind or Shanivarpet or something like that. For us, District Pune, considered as a whole, may be enough. Because, anyway, see, again, here the problem is some people might say that no, you should focus separately because hilly areas in Pune might have more occurrence of birds, whereas industrialized areas of Pune might show very less presence of birds, etc. This is completely acceptable. But the problem is, finally, we want to correlate this to some urbanization parameters because, as I said, our aim was to check impact of urbanization on bird diversity. So when I say I want to check impact of urbanization statistically on bird diversity, I need to have some parameters or some variables which measure urbanization. So we actually decided that we can take percent. Okay. So what are the parameters which can probably measure urbanization? Hello? Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Ma'am, we can get some idea from the district, or if latitude or longitude is possible to obtain from the data set, then sometimes it can also give some idea on the
I did not
urbanization or the.
realize exactly what data you are talking about. I did not understand. Can you please elaborate?
Urbanization means actually let me think actually.
Yeah. I want some quantifiable variable, and of course, I know my knowledge is limited. So I see, for example, I can tell that okay, for some districts of Maharashtra, I can tell fine ki Mumbai, Pune are comparatively more urbanized than say Dhule. I can say something like that, but I cannot do this manually for entire country. I don't even know the names of all the districts. In fact, I can't tell this even for all districts in Maharashtra. I don't know whether between say Akola and Chandrapur, which is more urbanized, I may not be able to tell. So I need something quantifiable, something which can probably be found in some data set online, some secondary source online. Any ideas?
Maybe population
People living
density.
in a
Okay.
yes, people living in 1 kilometer square area.
Okay, so I think both the people are going towards same direction. Population density, someone said, and people living in 1 square kilometer area would actually be something like population density. Okay.
Ma'am,
Okay.
I have one.
Wait, wait, wait. Population density is a good indicator. Okay. Anything else? Okay. By the way, generally, higher population density would mean higher urbanization or reverse way?
Higher urbanization.
Correct. So generally, in urban areas, people tend to be more clustered. Houses tend to be too clustered, so you have more urbanization. Then generally, you tend to have more population density. Okay.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Since I am having the district column with my in this data set, so I can go with the district wise average income of that yeah.
Okay. It actually, yes, it seems like a good indicator, but the problem is in India, we never officially collect income data. We are not allowed to collect income data. So
Ma'am,
far,
the
so far.
contribution, the taxes.
But that would be you yourself know how realistic it would be. it's a proxy, it's a good proxy, no doubt. And but I don't know if tax data is also made publicly available. Probably not. People won't like to make it public. And income, as I said, direct income major question, income related data collection is so far not allowed in India.
Maybe power consumption data if we have.
Correct. Power consumption data is one indicator. Good. Anything else? Nothing else comes to mind?
Road density.
Road density, okay. That is again another good point. Road density, correct. Okay, so we have thought of all such variables and of course getting the data in the required time frame.
Also, one thing, the if we can get the cost of living index.
Correct.
District wise, then
okay.
Also, yeah.
Okay, so cost of living could probably be indicator of urbanization. Again, it would be slightly, it could slightly be misleading also.
Across state, it would be misleading.
Correct, correct, misleading. Correct. Because, you know, you have seen rankings, you might have seen rankings. Newspapers regularly have some news items related to cost of living indices. So, sometimes it could be misleading. But yes, it is a valid variable to be put under consideration. So we thought of some such variables and tried to get data, and we could get data on, of course, very few variables. So one thing which on which we directly had data was percentage of urban population. So in census, you have categorization of rural and urban. So for every district, we could take percentage of urban population. So if more proportion of population is living in urban areas, we would consider that the urbanization is more for that district, higher for that district. Okay. Then another thing that we could get was number of vehicles. I think number of new RTO registrations or total number of vehicles from somewhere we could get. I don't remember the source exactly. So we converted that to vehicle density. So number of vehicles per person sort of thing. Okay. So again, that is also, I know that that is also not a perfect indicator, because for example, in Pune, more people are going to have two wheelers than in say, Mumbai, but some sort of indicator. So such variables were constructed for urbanization, and we could not get such variables having, what do you call, resolution below the district level. Okay, we could get only up to district level. As a result, we wanted bird diversity also to be computed only at the district level. So even if I have data for individual villages, I cannot use that data because I cannot correlate it directly to urbanization parameters, which I have only at the district level. So we realized that yes, I need only district level values, and that too, even one value per day is enough for us. So then what we realized is, we may not really need 86 lakh rows. So what we finally need is data in this format. So I need date, then I need name of the district, and maybe name of the state additionally if I want to keep track, and then count of unique species. That's all, correct? For a particular date, let us say 1st January 2000. 15, I think the data was still 14 or 15, I don't know. So for say 1st January 2015, if I write down district Pune, state Maharashtra, then how many unique species of birds were found on that day? So let us say 18, something like that. And then I don't, as of now, it seems that I don't really care as to how many people have really contributed there, means how many checklists were submitted which resulted in this count of 18 species. Okay, it seems that way. So now, first of all, not only these 10 rows, but all the additional rows for Pune corresponding to that date all got clubbed into one single row. Are you getting this? How my number of rows would be reduced? Whoever reported any number of birds in Pune that day, Pune means entire Pune district, all those people all their readings got combined into this single row. Okay, as a result, my data size reduced drastically. Okay, so for 1 year, if I want data for 1 year, then I have 365 days and whatever number of districts are there in India. Okay, so for Maharashtra, I think we have 35 districts. So it became 365 into 35 rows for Maharashtra. Similarly for other state. So the data size reduced really significantly. Okay, and as a result, now the file size became very small and people, students could handle it on their own laptops. Okay, so even though the initial file size was, I think it was 20 plus GB because 84 lakhs rows, but then final file size was below 1 GB. So they could manage things on their laptop. Of course, we realized later that we cannot really stop here because there is another thing. We can call it maybe efforts. See, the thing is, this is not a systematic census type of exercise. As I said, we got this data from a website called eBird. Okay, so this is not really a very thorough exercise. What happens is, bird watchers, there are many bird watchers across the country. Some of them know about this site, others may not know about this site. How many of you knew about this site before? Of course, some of you might have heard from me, but others who knew from any other source? Is there anyone who knew about this site before hearing from me? No? See, so awareness is not much. Okay, exactly. I'm not blaming you. It is not known. Even I did not know about it until I actually came across someone who uploaded checklist here. So, and this is the condition in Maharashtra. In remote states, this is the condition in Pune. So, in remote places, situation is even worse. People don't know about this site. So, of course, number of people from, say, Pune city who upload their checklists on this website is much higher than, say, number of people from Gadchiroli who upload their checklists here. Are you getting what I'm trying to say here?
Yes, ma'am.
As a result, birds found in Pune are much more likely to get reported than birds found in Gadchiroli. So, what we need is, somewhere we need to account for that factor also. So, then we decided that we want count of unique checklists or count of SEIs, means how many people had uploaded for every day. So we got that count here. So for example, in Pune, suppose 10 people have recorded for that day, then we wrote 10 here, so that we tried to scale this count by this. Okay, we tried to scale this count by a number of checklists. Okay, so this is how we reduced the data, and then things became pretty manageable. So this is what I'm trying to say. Whenever you have a data, even if you have unstructured data, the data may seem huge, but then it's your job to identify which parts of the data are really useful to you. Can you create new variables? So for example, we created this new variable, both the variables, count of unique species as well as count of SEI. These variables were not really present in the data as it is, but we created them by aggregating the data from multiple rows satisfying certain conditions. For example, matching this date and this district. Okay, so this such creation of new variables, modification of existing variables, etc., and of course cleaning of data and handling missing values in the data, all these things take a lot of time. Okay, hence such pre-processing of the data is of utmost importance. And now you must have realized, if we were unable to think of this, then we would have been stuck here itself. How to handle 84 lakh rows? How to go ahead? We would have then probably tried to consider a sample of the data, but then that sample would not have been representative. There would have been lot of issues. Okay, So understanding your problem, reframing your data to suit your needs is the most important part of the pre-processing. Let me stop here. Thank you.